Hey, welcome to Trinity Online. I'm Andrew.
And I'm Dave. And Andrew, I'm in denial.
Why is that?
Well, it's the last week of August, which means we are headed toward the fall.
Oh, you said it. It was inevitable.
You know how I know?
How?
Coffee shops have started serving pumpkin spice.
No. Oh, is that your barometer of the changing seasons?
I never claimed to be a smart man. But Andrew, as you look back at your summer experience, what have been a couple of highlights for you?
Ooh, that's a good question. Okay, two things come to mind. First, this summer has been our first summer with our new dog.
Oh, sweet.
So Maverick, our golden retriever, has made us get out for even more walks and hikes to explore our beautiful city.
So great.
And two, partway through the summer, our music and tech team started watching Trinity Online live on our Saturdays after we finished recording the weekend music set. So we're meeting right here in the courtyard. It's been really great just to be together in community, even with all of the social distancing requirements.
I totally agree. Those gatherings have been so, so sweet.
How about you, Dave?
Yeah, I've loved the online experience with our team right here, our watch party. That's been super cool. And I must say, because of the COVID kind of thing that we're all a part of, we've just kind of stuck around at home. And but our family has actually watched more sunsets, I think, this year than ever before, whether it's on a walk, on a patio, or riding our bikes through the city. I love that magic hour at night.
But that sunset, it's happening earlier and earlier every night, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't want to talk about it.
Come on, Dave. I thought you were adaptable. Embrace the change.
No, stop. Stop.
All right. Speaking of change, there are some changes coming to Trinity Online and how we are doing our weekend gatherings this fall.
Okay. So that is big news.
It is.
Okay. So spill it.
All right. You ready?
Yep.
Changes are coming and we'll start releasing that info this week.
Okay. So all of this was a giant teaser for all of you to come back next week and watch again?
Yeah. 100%.
That's genius.
Well, you know.
You should be in communication.
I should.
Well, info about what's happening in our fall is coming next week. We have a great service in store for you today.
Trinity Online, it starts right now.
Welcome to Trinity. I don't know about you, but our team is coming into this time with great anticipation, with the knowledge that our words, our songs, our praises are not left unheard. They're met by a God who chooses to come into our moment, into our life, our circumstance. So we invite you to join with us today as we meet with Him.
Stir a passion in my heart, God. Let it overflow. Let it overflow. Stir a passion in my heart, God. Let it overflow. Let it overflow. Breathe on me, Holy. Your beauty calls me deeper in. Stir a passion in my heart, God. Let it overflow. Let it overflow. Stir a passion in my heart, Let it overflow.
There's a famous story known as the prodigal son in the Gospel of Luke. Jesus tells us this story to help us understand the passionate love that God has for each one of us. In the story, the son takes advantage of his father's generosity and runs away. He lives life in the fast lane, and only when he burns through his resources and has nowhere else to turn, he heads home to his father, only to find out that his father has been waiting for his return all along. In fact, the story says that the father sees the son coming even a long way off and runs to meet him. Throughout the Bible, there's a constant theme. God is a good God, and that goodness pursues us. It chases us. 1 Chronicles 16:34 says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever." I don't know about you, but there have been so many moments in my life that I would not describe as good. Now, some of those moments have been my own choices, my own running away. And some moments have happened to me. Maybe you can relate. But if I'm really honest, if I really evaluate my circumstances, I can see that through the situations of life that might not seem good, God still is. When life is hard, there are three simple questions I ask myself. One, what do I see? Can I see the goodness of God in my life despite the bad? Two, what do I hear? If I can't see the goodness of God, can I hear what he's saying in my situation? And three, what do I remember? If I can't see God's goodness and I can't hear what he's saying, I can always remember what God has done for me in the past. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, as we've even just quickly revisited that story of the prodigal son, we're reminded of the way that you pursue us, that you chase after us, and that you love us in the midst of situations in our life that are good and in the midst of circumstances that are really hard. God, you are constant, you are good, and we give you thanks. Would you remind us that you're with us today, no matter what our situation and circumstances look like? We're so grateful. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, just this past week, the team here at the church had the option to meet in person for a social distance all-staff meeting. It was the first time we'd done that since March. So we met outside on the patio, set up our big screen to zoom in anyone who wanted to attend virtually. But when the meeting started, there wasn't one person on the Zoom call. Everybody had showed up in person. We were so excited to be in community together. And for the first half hour, we just told stories. Stories of God's goodness, ways that he's been working in and through our church. Here are just a few of those stories.
When our compassion meals first began, we reached out to some teachers who attend here, encouraging them to let us know if there are families who could benefit from receiving a meal each week. Families are balancing so much these days, it's a privilege to help through just a simple meal. One of the families who participated is a single mom of five and is struggling with her second bout of cancer. My heart breaks with every update she shares. Not only have we been able to provide her family with meals each week, some of our amazing volunteers have walked alongside her by caring for her yard and bringing goodies for her kids. Through these simple gestures, this mom, struggling with so much, noticed something different in the driver that delivered the meal. The notes left in the meal bags and the kind gestures for herself and her kids. No strings attached. Then this past week, she texted me asking if she could get connected to our church. We can never underestimate the power of small acts of kindness. Our meal program is touching so many lives of people from Lake Country to Penticton. This is what yet another participant had to say. I'd like to thank each and every one of your volunteers. It is people like you that not only bring great food, you bring life and a reason to carry on. There's nothing better than hearing that doorbell or knock on the door. You might be the only face I've seen in a week. Your friendly smile means so much more than you realize.
This summer, through a series of events only God could have orchestrated, I spent my summer vacation riding my motorcycle with a group of bikers I had never previously met in support of a charity I hadn't heard of prior to June, the Military Police Fund for Blind Children. You may be wondering if this new addition was an attempt to fit in better with such a crowd. Well, it certainly didn't hurt. The truth is that it started the day Trinity had to shut our doors back in March and serves as a constant reminder to me of how long it's been since we've met together in person, but also of the opportunity for growth in a new direction. You see, the Fund for Blind Children organizes a fundraising ride every summer that starts in Victoria and passes the baton from province to province until it ends in St. John's, Newfoundland. This year, many provinces opted out as COVID restrictions made it too difficult to travel and to fundraise. But the BC chapter refused to quit, and through persistence and creativity, worked within the provincial regulations and with the local COVID sentiment in each community to visit as many places as possible, and extended the usual 5-day BC leg to a 14-day provincial loop. The result? Through face masks and hand sanitizer and elbow bumps, and the generosity of my fellow Trinity staff and tech team volunteers, as well as many other generous individuals and organizations, we raised nearly half of the national goal just in BC. The lesson? There will always be limitations in life, but that doesn't affect the worthiness of the cause. God is still worthy of our worship and our generosity. People are still longing for community and relationship, perhaps more than ever. Yes, we're all longing for the day we can meet again by the thousands instead of by the dozens. But if COVID can't stop a fundraiser on two wheels, then it certainly can't stop the church. Let's be persistent. Let's get creative. Let's worship and give and reach out to our neighbors and our community. Love God, love others, and change the world through Jesus, in COVID and always.
On Thursday, April 8th, 2020, Jordan received a telephone call from her daughter's daycare to come and pick up her 2-year-old little girl, Abigail. By the time Jordan arrived to the daycare, Abigail was in excruciating pain and could not hold her own weight on her legs. She was rushed to the emergency at Kelowna General Hospital as she began to lose function of the rest of her body, including her breathing. She was sedated and placed on a ventilator, given antibiotics and steroids, while tests were run, including COVID-19, which came back negative. Jordan was told her daughter has inflammation of the spine called transverse myelitis, which is a rare inflammatory disease. Abigail was transferred to BC Children's in Vancouver, where she began a lengthy treatment with an unknown future. Friends of Jordan's immediately set up a GoFundMe for Abigail, not knowing the length of the journey or what that would look like for her and her mom. The GoFundMe was raised over and above what was originally thought possible to help and support this family. Our team connected with Jordan to try and support her in any way we could. I felt drawn to her and a connection with Jordan due to having a sick child of my own and understanding what that feels like to a mom. Jordan continues to give us updates on Abigail's progress. Abigail endured a long 5 months of healing and intensive therapy with her loving mom at her side. Through God's amazing love and Abigail's incredible determination for that 2-year-old, Abigail is being released from hospital on September 18th. Jordan shared some incredible videos of Abigail jamming to some of Trinity's worship during a weekend service. A quote from Jordan, "God is definitely living in her heart. God has a plan for Abigail, and we cannot wait to see her story unfold."
Stories of God working in our community never get old. God is still very much alive and chasing us down, showing us his goodness. And if you have ever given a dollar to the work and mission of Trinity, you share a part of making these and so many more stories possible. So if you're giving today, thank you for your generosity. We're so excited about what God is doing in and through our community. Well, today we wrap up our Reimagine series as Scott talks about Reimagine the Future You. And then next week, we'll have our final Best of Trinity weekend for the summer. And this time, we'll be looking back at the best of moments that we've had since we've gone online only. And there have been a lot of them. So make sure you don't miss it. But right now, here's Scott with Reimagine the Future You.
Over the course of the summer, we have been working week by week with this idea. If we're willing to step back and assess our lives in areas like leadership, our neighborhoods and worship and even our own story, if we're willing to recalibrate and awaken those places, they can be reimagined and take us in a completely different direction. Today, we're on the backside of the Reimagine series. Now, maybe for some of you, it is the front side because you're on that puppy all summer. So welcome back. Now, interestingly, all of these weekends point in one single direction, forward, to the future, who you are and who you are becoming. Another way to put it is the future you. Like, what do you imagine your life to be like in 10 years? Where will you live? What will you be doing? Who will you be? Well, today is the first step to the future you. Now, pretty much every day, Carla and I, or at least one of us and some of our crew, take Hazel, our cockapoo puppy, out for a walk. And yes, thanks to my crew, Hazel even has her own Instagram page. Now, on that walk, we pass a few beaches, intersections, restaurants, and people. Every kind of people. It's amazing. Tourists, Albertans, volleyball players, bike riders, swimmers, and those people who seem to think you want to listen to their music, you know, that they blast it and they're like, well, everybody wants to hear what I love. It's actually a people mecca. You can't help watching them all. And in the middle of all that individuality, it occurred to me, there is one constant. People with phenomenal talent, incredible potential, unlimited capacity, rarely live up to what is inside of them. Rarely. Some of you know this. You're young. You're in your 20s. And you already feel like you've wasted so much of your life. It's actually almost more than you can bear. Some of you are watching today and you sense there is this haunting emptiness in your soul. Nothing can overcome it. And even though you're frantically trying to keep things together, your family, cleaning everything at home, relationships, your workplace, all this stuff, something triggers inside. It warns you that you're missing the reason for your existence. Whatever your intention was, it somehow is eluding you. I actually think most of us live our lives with this overwhelming sense of regret and loss. And not just in this season of losing so much. I actually think some of it is a misunderstanding of how life works, no matter your faith perspective. Actually, I believe many people of faith have this superstitious perspective of the future, rooted in a misunderstanding about God. So the narrative kind of goes like this. Well, the Bible says that God planned me before he planned the earth. That's true. Or God had a purpose for me before he created the universe. Again, true. And so since God has a plan and a purpose for my life, planned billions of years before I was born, it must all be preset, pre-planned, and predestined. There's actually no choice in it for me. The Bible teaches the exact opposite. Yes, God does have a plan. Yes, God does have a purpose, but you can miss it. It is not automatic. And most people are missing the purpose of their life. Most people waste their lives. You know, the Bible repeatedly tells us that God doesn't force himself on you. He isn't like a puppet master pulling the strings of your existence. No, you and I have and can accept or reject his will. We can obey or not obey. We can follow or we can go the opposite direction. We don't understand that to live the life you are created to live, to discover the true future ahead of you, you have to choose it. You have to choose the future. You ever thought about how many choices you have to make in a day? Like seriously, you ever sat down and gone, man, how many choices do you make? There are actually every single day choices that are essential to our survival. Exercising, breathing, drinking, sleeping, eating. Do you ever get tired of choosing what to eat? Like every single day, like breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and trying to come up that? We do. We do at our house. It's often. Carla and I are talking about supper on her way home from work. She'll give me a call. And on those nights we haven't planned ahead of time, she says to me, hey, what do you feel like tonight? And I'm like, I don't know. Tacos? And she's like, nope. And I'm like, pasta? Nope. Okay, barbecue some burgers? She's like, I don't think so. And then I'm like, okay, here's what we're going to do, babe. You just tell me what I want, and then we can get it right. High five. That's the best way to do it. Hey, don't look at me like that. All of you have been in that situation, too. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, so here is the fundamental question. Are you making good choices? See, the thing is, it doesn't matter how old you are, where you live, what you drive, what pod you're going to be in at school this fall. It is a critical question. Are you making good choices? Even the totality of our spiritual life is actually connected. Prayer and worship, reading the Bible and serving, they're all connected to this one thing, a choice. You see, before you pray, you have to choose to pray. Before you serve, you have to choose to serve. Before you love, you have to choose to love. See, to choose is the most spiritual activity you will engage in. Your entire life is influenced by choosing, which is why when you read through the pages of Scripture, you run into these epic intersections where God drives people to a moment, a place where they have to make a choice. Like the choice that loomed on the banks of the Red Sea for the people of Israel. Kind of like this beach. You can find it in Exodus chapter 14, starting at verse 10. So I encourage you, grab your Bible or your phone and turn to it. It goes Genesis and Exodus in the Bible. It's the second book of the Bible, Exodus chapter 14. And I got to give a shout out. If you want to go deeper this week, I encourage you, check out this book by Erwin McManus called The Last Arrow. It had some powerful understandings of what choosing the future can be all about. Hey, as you're turning to Exodus chapter 14, even if you don't know the Bible, you know this story from the movies. Prince of Egypt, the Ten Commandments, even VeggieTales, Mo in the Big Exit. I don't know where that came from, VeggieTales, but VeggieTales in the Mo Exit even talks about Moses taking the Israelites out of Egypt. You see, for 400 years, the Israelites have been in captivity. And what started out as a few people is now millions, about 2 million strong at this point. And they're slaves in the most powerful nation on earth at the time, under the authority of the most powerful man in the world at the time, Pharaoh. Now, pharaohs were considered a god, and whatever they told you to do must be done, or it was your life they would take. And through a cornucopia of events, Moses was called by God to lead his people to freedom. And fresh off the 10 plagues in Egypt, which triggered their release from slavery, they're hightailing it out of there. And now standing between them and freedom is the Red Sea, thousands of feet deep and 30 kilometers wide. The problem was Pharaoh had changed his mind. He loaded up 600 of his best chariots and all the other chariots in Egypt and troops and horsemen in hot pursuit. And it picks up in verse 10. It says, as Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after him. They were terrified and cried out to the Lord. They can hear the approaching army. They can see the cloud of dust in the distance. They can hear the roar of the chariots, and they are afraid. No, they are terrified, and they start imagining worst-case scenarios. Now, I get it. That was a huge army hunting them down, probably some of their owners hunting them down. And they endured one of the most evil empires for hundreds of years. But why is being terrified the automatic response? Did you think about that? Like, why would that be the thing that comes out of their heart and mind? See, days earlier, they had just witnessed God unleash 10 plagues on the Egyptian people in all of God's jaw-dropping power. Yet in that moment, in the heat of the sun, in the mass of bodies, they saw what was there and they forgot who God was. They were terrified. And even though God had set them miraculously free, they lost confidence that God could actually finish the job. You ever been in that place where you say, hey, I'll believe in God if I just see a miracle? Matter of fact, I would never doubt again. You ever thought that, okay, God, if you just show up this once, that would be epic. I will never turn my back on you again. It's just not true, is it? You forget by the next day. Isn't that why some of you are watching today? You just lost the hope of who God is? You see, yesterday's faith never seems to keep us from tomorrow's crisis. Yesterday's faith never seems to keep us from tomorrow's crisis. That is why a lot of us panic. We begin trusting God, and then life happens, and we somehow think that God isn't coming through, that somehow our lives caught him by surprise. Look what it says in verse 11. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than die in the desert. What have you done to us, Moses? You just decided it wasn't good enough for us to die in Egypt, so you brought us out here in the middle of nowhere to die? Moses, we don't know what it's like to be free. We don't know what it's like to live free. Why can't we just go back to Egypt? Let us go back, Moses. It was better there." It's like they're hyperventilating, panicking. You can just feel it, can't you? So much so, they literally become delusional. "Didn't we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." You know what? They actually never said that. It was completely opposite. You can read it for yourself. They were crying out for help. "Help us, Moses." Don't miss this. A lot of us are afraid of the future because it's different than the past, and it's scary. You would, rather be trapped in the past than step into the future God has for you. Even though you hate this life, it is the life you know. And you don't know what's on the other side, so I'll hold on to this miserable existence, and then it happens. Perceptions are embraced as realities. You know that, right? We have an idea, a belief, that because we step in tomorrow, we're somehow living out our future selves. It's not true. See, tomorrow is coming no matter what you do. The future comes based on what you choose to do. Let me say that again. Tomorrow is coming no matter what you do. The future comes based on what you choose to do. And some of you are burning up tomorrows because you haven't chosen to step into what God has for you. You're trapped in the past, cycling the same mistakes and choices and fears and pains over and over and over again. And Moses answered the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you'll see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again." Do you know what the single most often repeated command in Scripture? Think of it for a minute. Do you know what it is? Do not fear. Do not be afraid. You see, I'm sure Moses could see this getting out of control in an instant. It was scary. It was terrifying. The future did not look so bright that he had to wear shades. That was a shout out to anyone over 40. They said it because it was scary, because the mystery of the future was unknown. And if you allow it to, the past will always grab you and suck you back, always. As bad as it was in the past, it's comfortable, isn't it? It's known. The future is so mysterious. Now, hold on for a second. Have you ever prayed a huge prayer of faith in expectation of what God might do in the future? Something for your life? Hey, God, could you do something great in my life? And it didn't happen. And we cry out to God, "What were you thinking?" You see, if you want God to do something great in life, you have to go through great hardships in your life, crisis. So don't ask God to do something great, but keep your challenges small. Great men and women look for great challenges. We pray and want God's outcome, but not his process. And he brings us out of slavery into the uncertainty of freedom. And yet freedom brings responsibility. And the safety of slavery can be so much more attractive. Can it? Now, come on now. You ever find yourself there? Still dating that guy? That job that you're miserable in? Those relationships that have those addictive patterns? They just suck you back, don't they? It's always the worst part of our past that pursues us the most, isn't it? Look at verse 14. It says, "The Lord will fight for you. You only need to be still." You only need to be still. It's reminiscent of that passage from Psalms that says, "Be still and know that I am God." Do you want to know why God said that? It wasn't because the Israelites were trying to move too fast. Or it wasn't because the Israelites were trying to move forward. It was because they were trying to move backwards. You see, God never tells someone to be still that has too much faith or too much action or too much activity. God doesn't say, I can't keep up with you because you have so much faith, so be still. When you are terrified, when you are afraid, when the path ahead is unclear, God says, be still. Calm your heart. I will fight for you. Today, if you're ready to give up and retreat, returning to whatever held you in slavery, be still. Let him fight for you. God only moves forward into the future, and he wants to take you there. And God's got your back, so keep moving forward. Check out verse 15. Then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on. Raise your staff and stretch your hand over the sea to divide the water so that Israelites can go through the sea on dry ground. Now, wait a second. Hang on. Don't miss that. Isn't that a weird thing for God to say? Hey, Moses, don't cry out to me. Don't pray, Moses. I don't recall ever hearing something like that in church. Do you? I'm sure none of you parents, when your little one is saying their bedtime prayers, like, shh, just stop. Just, yeah, don't do it anymore. Like, why aren't they supposed to pray? You see, a lot of us hide behind spiritual language to hide our spiritual emptiness. We pray because we're afraid to act. We be still because we're paralyzed from fear. God's like, why are you praying now? Don't you see the Egyptians coming? Giddy up, get out of there. Moses, point the staff, split the waters, and move. You see, the problem is evil men don't wait for God's permission like Pharaoh. But good people sit back and they say, why doesn't God do something? I'll just pray. Why are you praying, God says? Why don't you do something? God says, I have done something. I created you. Why don't you do something? You see, the future doesn't just happen. You make the future happen. It doesn't come to you. You stand on the banks of a shore. You stand on the banks of a decision at the epicenter of your life, and you have a choice, and God says, choose it. Choose to choose your future and follow me. See, every single day of your life and my life, every moment, we have to lean in and trust that God has a future for you. Yes, even in the middle of COVID, that your life, that the world can be better than it is, that we can usher in the future that he's hoping for you. And if you aren't choosing the future, you're ending up in the wrong one. So I wonder what choice God is waiting for you to make right now. What purpose does he have for you that you don't even know yet? Imagine if you and me decided today to live a life that chose to find the purpose of what God has created you for. The hope, the joy, the potential, the purpose that goes beyond the facts of your life right now. That even though you can't see the future, you go, you know what? It's time for me to create the new. 2 Timothy 1:7 puts it this way. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. See, I believe there's a choice you need to make right now. I don't know what it is, but it will help you create the future. And I believe God in this moment, by his Spirit, will start to make that aware to you. As a matter of fact, that has been my prayer for you today, that in this moment, God would help you understand. And yes, it might be terrifying. It may cost you. It may be full of fear. But you need to step into it. You need to choose the future you. And for some of you, that might be choosing to follow Jesus that 2,000 years ago, he died on the cross, choosing to give his life for you. And it's time for you to cross that line of faith and give your life to Jesus and receive the future he has given you. And it's just a simple prayer. Jesus, I give you my life today. I choose a future with you as my Savior and Lord. It's that simple. And if you give him your life, he will give you his life, a future and a hope. Let go so God can bring the new. What has been birthed inside of you. He can lead you to the future he planned and imagined from the very beginning. He can lead you out of Egypt too. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we can see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. I love the song the band's going to sing, Egypt. It's the narrative that God can take us into a future if we just have the courage to step into it. Why don't you have that courage and step into it today?
I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. 'Cause you found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh. Cloud by day is a sign that you are with me. The fire by night is a guiding light to my feet. 'Cause you found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're the God.
Hey, thanks for joining us today.
And don't forget that if you'd like to go deeper on the content that Scott was teaching on today, just go to the website under messages or fire up your app and look for the Going Deeper questions.
And make sure that you are here next weekend for the Best of Trinity Part 3 as we look back at some of our favorite moments since being online.
And don't forget, enjoy those pumpkin spice lattes.
We'll see you next week.
You give away your freedom from my heart. The price you paid to give it to.